The precise start of World War I is often a matter of debate. Does it start with Austria-Hungary attacking Serbia, Russia declaring war on Austria-Hungary, Germany going to war with Russia, France going to war with Germany, Germany invading Belgium, or the British declaring war on Germany, or some other date? The point of this is to highlight that the war didn't start equally in all places at once. Today, we're going to look at an incident that, in the conventional timeline of the war, takes place at least half a year in, but from the local context, was practically the opening shot, at least in this particular theatre. The root causes lay back in 1914. Italy was notionally a member of the Central Powers, or more properly, the Triple Alliance, along with Germany and Austria-Hungary. But when war had come, the Italians had stayed neutral. There were reasons for this. Both the Triple Alliance and the Triple Entente were supposed to be defensive alliances, whilst Germany and Austria-Hungary had declared war, which was an offensive action. Secondly, under the terms of the Triple Alliance, Austria-Hungary and Italy were supposed to talk to each other before doing anything drastic in the Balkans, which was an area of mutual interest, such as, say, declaring war on Serbia. However, Austria-Hungary had talked to Germany, mainly to get its backing against Russia, but not Italy. And so the Italians decided they were going to stay out of the first round of the war, and also began secret talks with the Triple Entente. Whilst the Central Powers were prepared to offer some territorial concessions to keep Italy neutral, since these mostly involved giving away territory that one or the other power already owned, these concessions were relatively small, far less than what Italy actually wanted. The Triple Entente, on the other hand, could afford to be quite generous with other people's lands, especially when those people were currently fighting against them, and thus they promised Italy a lot more of what it wanted, which mainly consisted of significant chunks of what was currently Austro-Hungarian territory. After a fair bit of internal political division and protest, Italy would eventually end up declaring war on Austria-Hungary, entering the war on the side of the Triple Entente, on the 23rd of May 1915. Followed over the rest of the year by declarations of war against the rest of the Central Powers, which now included the Ottoman Empire, Bulgaria, and of course Germany. The Austro-Hungarian ruler, a wonderfully titled King and Emperor, or more properly Kaiser und König, a title which we'll come back to later, was obviously somewhat displeased at a supposed ally first turning neutral and then actively turning against him, with said King and Emperor, Franz Joseph I, declaring it to be the treason of the century. By this point in the war's progress, an Anglo-French force, albeit mostly French, had been bottling up the Austro-Hungarian navy already to keep them from interfering in the wider Mediterranean theatre. But with Italy's neutrality up to this point, the blockade was somewhat distant and patchy, letting the Austro-Hungarian navy have run of much of the Adriatic, as even the relatively distant Otranto barrage was still in the future. That wasn't to say that this period had been without incident. In mid-August 1914, a small Austro-Hungarian protected cruiser and a single accompanying destroyer were blockading the port of Antivari, when two French dreadnoughts, 10 pre-dreadnoughts, two armoured cruisers, protected cruiser and 5 units of destroyers, accompanied by 2 British armoured cruisers and 3 more destroyer formations, descended on them in one of the most unequal battles in naval history. Still, the Austro-Hungarian cruiser SMS Zenta threw itself into the fight with enough vigour that by the time it was inevitably sunk, the destroyer SMS Uhlan had slipped away. The whole point of that battle had been to lure out the main Austro-Hungarian fleet, which even in its entirety would have been significantly outgunned at this point. But in the event, they didn't actually realise what was happening until the encounter was nearly over, and so didn't sail out. Over the next few months, Allied formations would sail up the Adriatic several more times, trying to lead elements of the Kaiserliche und Königliche Kriegsmarine, to give the Austro-Hungarian Navy its full title, into battle. However, the Austro-Hungarian commanders didn't especially feel like suicidal charges against massed foes, and so the Austro-Hungarian fleet remained in port during these incursions. an attempt to shell the Austro-Hungarian base at Kataro, now called Kotor, with land-based artillery in a manner similar to the Japanese artillery during the siege of Port Arthur during the Russo-Japanese War, came to an abrupt end when, with the French supporting fleet headed back to Malta to refuel and reprovision, the last-generation pre-dreadnought SMS Radzetsky rolled up and forced the gun crews to abandon their positions by judicious application of 12-inch high-explosive rounds, where the 9.4-inch guns of an older Habsburg-class pre-dreadnought had failed to accomplish the same goal. The Marine Nationale's luck got worse still when the Austro-Hungarian submarine SMS U-12 managed to land a torpedo hit on the Corbeil-class dreadnought Jean Bart, sending it back to Malta to repair the hole in the bow, which was where the wine store had once been. With winter closing in, both sides retreated to glaring at each other from the opposite ends of the Adriatic, and not a tremendous amount would happen over the winter of 1914 and going into 1915. But as the better weather of spring 1915 turned around, there came more active recon by the Austro-Hungarian Navy along the Italian coast, as indications were building of troop movements that presaged the Italian declaration of war. These missions had been dispatched by the Austro-Hungarian Intelligence Service, which was cunningly named the Evidenzbüro. Thus, while the Italian declaration of war came a week later, betrayal or not, the Austro-Hungarian fleet was ready and waiting. On the same day as the declaration of war, which occurred around 3:30 in the afternoon, fast units already on reconnaissance patrol, which came to a total of two destroyers, SMS Dinara and SMS Laika, as well as the torpedo boat TB-53T, launched minor bombardments of communications infrastructure, as well as launching a few shells into the harbour of Ancona. The Italian destroyer Turbine challenged the Laika as it went after some of the semaphore and radio installations that could be found along the shoreline, but the Italian came off somewhat the worse for wear. This was hardly surprising, as Turbine was a fraction over 300 tons and barely outgunned a particularly heavily armed World War II tank, whilst Laika, although still small for a World War I era destroyer, was, at almost 900 tons, about three times the Turbine's displacement and carried considerably heavier armament. However, a much more powerful response to the declaration of war was being prepared. At about 4 in the afternoon, half an hour after the war had officially begun, Admiral Anton Haus gave orders to raise steam, which were passed to virtually all available and serviceable modern units of the Kaiserliche und Königliche Kriegsmarine. By 1900, a reconnaissance squadron consisting of the cruisers Saida and Sigetvar, along with the destroyers Balaton and Triglav, headed out to prepare the way. The psychological objective was primarily to raise Austro-Hungarian morale, with the practical goals of damaging Italian morale with a rapid counterstrike, as well as damaging Italian transport links to the new front. Since only two railway lines ran north to south on the eastern side of the country at this point, and one of them was coastal, which translated into an easy target. Halving the logistical capacity of the Italian army at a stroke would make life much easier for the Austro-Hungarian troops to the north. At the centre of the Austro-Hungarian fleet were three of the four Tegetthoff-class dreadnoughts, as Svend István was not yet commissioned. Numerically, this put the Austro-Hungarian fleet practically on a par with the Italian Regia Marina, as Dante Alighieri and Giulio Cesare had been in commission for some time now, but Conte de Cavour wasn't quite 2 months in service, and Leonardo da Vinci had precisely a week of operational activity under its belt, whilst the three Austro-Hungarian vessels were fully worked up. Still, to be on the safe side, Admiral Haus, who was determined to be on the front lines, placed his flag aboard the much older SMS Habsburg, leaving the newer ships behind as many protective escorts as he could muster. Led jauntily out of harbour by all 400 tons of SMS Sikos, a small destroyer that was more honestly classed as a large torpedo boat, came the Habsburg, Arpad, and Babenberg, then the Erzherzog Karl, Erzherzog Friedrich, and Erzherzog Ferdinand Max, the Erzherzog being the title Archduke, Then the larger forms of Viribus Unitis, Tegetthoff, and Prince Eugen, followed by SMS Franz Ferdinand, Radzetsky, and Zrinyi bringing up the rear, with a three-destroyer screen consisting of SMS Velibit, Rika, and Dinara completing the line formation. Almost two dozen torpedo boats and small destroyers swarmed on the flanks of the most powerful force the Kaiserliche und Königliche Kriegsmarine had ever fielded, as it headed for sea. Technically, at a 9-8 advantage before accounting for the capacity and capabilities of individual ships, this force also outnumbered the Regia Marina in pre-dreadnoughts, which would leave the outcome of any potential fleet action very much on a knife edge, at least on paper. Nine further vessels, including a number of cruisers and lighter craft, sailed in two smaller formations to more easily hit multiple targets. Nor were the surface ships the only elements being dispatched. Six Lerner L-type flying boats in two formations of three were also being sent out in a strike role, with a number of the torpedo boats having trained in refueling and rearming the flying boats at sea, along with a secondary role of towing any who might suffer engine failure or battle damage back home. Sailing at speed through the night, the various forces arrived off their target positions in the early hours of the morning of the 24th of May 1915. Furthest to the north, the Grand Harbour of Venice was found vulnerable to weapons of a new age as the northern group of flying boats swooped in, albeit that with a grand total payload of 600 kilograms of bombs between the three aircraft, there wasn't a massive amount of critical damage inflicted, albeit that the explosions and machine gun fire were quite disconcerting. Next down the coast, the ports of Ravenna and Porto Corsini found themselves subject to the attention of the smaller cruiser SMS Novara, the smaller destroyer SMS Scharfschütze, and four mid-sized torpedo boats, 78, 79, 80, and 81T. Their objective was to find and destroy Italian submarines that might be based in those ports, where the relatively short range of early submarines was less of a problem when it came to reaching Austro-Hungarian targets, as opposed to if they'd been based in the larger naval bases further south. None were seen, however, so the Scharfschütze identified a narrow channel into the inner harbour, swung around, and carefully reversed in. Still, no warships were found here either, and so Captain Novotny decided to shell anything else of military value that he could see, which included a signal station, some military warehouses and dock facilities, and a small artillery emplacement with accompanying infantry. In an hour of shooting, the ship expended 127 main battery shells, 910 rounds of machine gun ammunition, and somehow also 50 rounds of pistol ammunition, which is something I think bears some further investigation. Having suitably perforated the various targets of opportunity, the destroyer simply headed back out, as of course there was no need to turn around, sinking a couple of sail barges on the way out for good measure, hopefully using the pistol rounds. Not to be left out, Novara and the torpedo boats decided to shoot at anything suspicious looking in the outer harbour, but actually came off somewhat the worse for their efforts, losing 45 men to hits from various shore-based artillery emplacements, whilst the ATT took a hit below the waterline and was ordered to shelter behind the Novara to help it patch up the hole. With the destroyer emerging from the inner harbour and catching a few shells on the way out, the Novara's captain, one Miklos Horthy, sent the Scharfschütze and the ATT off home, fired a couple of parting shells for good measure, and then took the Novara and the other three torpedo boats off after some Italian warships that had been reported to be nearby heading to Trieste. Although, sometime later, a reconnaissance aircraft dropped a message to them stating that these earlier reports had been in error, and so the rest of this force would head home as well around dawn. At Rimini, the armoured cruiser SMS Sankt Georg and two small torpedo boats, named number 1 and number 2 despite not actually being the first and second torpedo boats in Austro-Hungarian service, found nothing much of interest except for a railway bridge, and so they blew a few holes in that before heading home in their own turn. The next target area further south was the main one, Ancona. As the main force approached this large port, the pre-dreadnought SMS Zrinyi and two torpedo boats broke off to target nearby Senigallia, now apparently called Senigallia, arriving at just after 3:30 in the morning with a list of targets that included army bases with their formations of troops who were awaiting transport north, and the railways in general, and particularly the railroad hub in the city, as well as factories, an oil refinery, and anything else that looked especially threatening and or explosive. And so at 3:52, at the order of Feuer auf Molo, they fired a warning shot from one of the 24cm secondary battery guns, albeit that the shell hit a pier, which promptly fled in many directions at once at high speed, leaving little more than a pall of smoke and pleasant memories. The warning shot having been given, the ships then allowed 8 minutes for any nearby civilians to make a run for it, before the tertiary battery opened up at the railway station at 4 o'clock on the dot. The larger guns engaged other targets, and soon chaos began to rain down. Several factories were hit and partially collapsed. A water tower lost a support leg and toppled over with a massive surge of water that paradoxically started a small fire, whilst elsewhere in the town the oil refinery took a direct hit that started a somewhat larger fire and many longing looks on the part of the citizens at where the water tower had so recently stood. A train appeared on a nearby river bridge and was also destroyed by rapid fire from the smaller guns, after which the Zrinyi was forced to do a quick 180-degree turn because the tertiary battery had been firing so enthusiastically that the guns were overheating, and so the other broadside had to be brought to bear. Amidst all the chaos, the Italian airship Città di Ferrara appeared, and accounts vary as to whether this or Ancona was her first port of call. It appears this was probably her first area of attack, but in either case, they now commenced a slow and intricate dance as the airship tried to hit the pre-dreadnought with one of its 6 bombs, and the battleship, which didn't have any anti-aircraft guns, slowly meandered around trying to avoid the same. After 90 minutes of this slow ballet, some Austro-Hungarian flying boats showed up and chased the airship away, pursued not only by the diminutive aircraft, but also by a considerable volume of rifle fire from crewmen who'd gotten somewhat bored about a quarter of an hour in and taken up basic AA duty with their service rifles, and not to mention, of course, a volley of various curses in all 11 official languages of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. With the morning's aerial entertainment concluded, these ships also headed for home, noting an apparent 3 separate submarine attacks on their way back, although given the circumstances and what's known of Regia Marina fleet dispositions, it's more likely that this was a product of adrenaline and exhaustion than any actual torpedo attempts. A bit further south off Ancona itself, things got even more interesting. The other 3 flying boats specced for strike missions were operating in attack mode and dived on the shore defences with their machine guns blazing, forcing the crews to abandon their guns temporarily. The late 1800s and early 1900s shore defences not really having been built with air attack in mind, and thus mostly having their fortifications and gun shields facing horizontally towards the sea. This accomplished, the flying boats headed off to try and bomb some hangars at the nearby Iesi airfield, albeit without much success. Offshore, 6 of the pre-dreadnoughts took up firing positions close in, with the dreadnoughts and the Erzherzog Franz Ferdinand covering a position somewhat further out. Ancona wasn't under blackout, and so targets were readily identifiable. The destroyers Velebit and Sikos sneaked into the harbour first, with Velebit sinking a steamer, which was probably the Greek Lemnos, and the Sikos destroying a pier, both using torpedoes, before shelling another steamer and a petrol refuelling position before heading back out to the fleet. This activity gave plenty of warning to the civilians in town that something bad was about to happen, which informs what follows, as despite a rather major bombardment by a considerable number of battleships, a grand total of only 68 deaths would be recorded, unfortunately 38 of them civilian, but still significantly less than you might expect. Each capital ship had been assigned a list of targets. SMS Habsburg had been told to target the Carlo Cipelli battery, the San Stefano military base, and the railway station. SMS Barbenberg had been ordered to target shipyards, another coastal battery, and an electrical plant. SMS Arpad had been ordered to target a gas plant, a water tower, which was apparently a relatively important piece of infrastructure on the Austro-Hungarian target list, an aqueduct, and the old citadel above the city, as well as some piers. SMS Ferdinand Max was targeting military bases to the north, a semaphore station, and a radio station. SMS Erzherzog Friedrich was targeting the dockyard and military bases to the south, and SMS Erzherzog Karl was targeting a few other military bases and the Enrico Cialdini battery. Whilst they were positioned further back, the Tegetthoffs were not left out of the action, as they'd been collectively tasked to take out a lighthouse, as well as the Alfredo Savio and Montagnola Chiesa batteries, since Admiral House did not want to risk his most modern ships in potential close-in action. As one might expect, a lot of things very quickly started to explode and or fall over. An auxiliary cruiser, the Città di Tripoli, was also hit, and significant damage as well as a number of fires were triggered all across the city. As dawn approached, the airship Città di Ferrara, you might remember that from its earlier encounter with the Zrini, put in an appearance. Only it found that this force did have a few anti-aircraft guns in the fleet, and so, with the flying boat still buzzing around it, the airship headed back to safety over land. Whilst mostly unopposed, the bombardment wasn't without problems. Virbis Unitis reported a major issue with its ventilation systems that supplied fresh air to the main turrets. The systems weren't anywhere near adequate, and the gun crews almost asphyxiated before deciding that opening the turret hatches, whilst a breach of battle protocol, was somewhat more preferable to a mix of gun smoke and hypoxia. Interestingly, however, neither of the reports from the other two dreadnoughts mentioned this as being a problem, and testing of rebuilt systems a few months later seemed to work perfectly well. So it appears that potentially, as was the case with the poor old SMS Sven Istvan, the Virbis Unitis or Tegetthoff class was subject once more to a rather irregular form of building quality control. There were a few more targets further south of Ancona. Porto de Potenza got a visit from SMS Radzetsky, which opened fire at 4:15, hitting bridges and a railway track before retiring. Meanwhile, at Termoli, the small cruiser SMS Admiral Spaun and four Hussar-class destroyers, the Streiter, Wildfang, Uskoka, and Ulan, opened fire at 4 in the morning, destroying a bridge over the river Sinarka and then sailing south to shell a railway line. Then a train that they found at the Campo Marino railway station, followed by a pumping station and a few other nearby targets of opportunity. After this, they went looking for even more targets as they sailed on down the Gargano Peninsula, taking shots at the signal station of Torre de Milito, and checked out the Tremiti Island harbour to see if there were any torpedo boats there. But it was empty, and so they also headed home. Finally, further down the Gargano Peninsula, a small formation of Austro-Hungarian ships would come across the only Regia Marina opposition to be encountered during the operation. The destroyer SMS Lika was still in the area and found a radio and semaphore signal station to destroy before heading to rendezvous with the southernmost Austro-Hungarian force. On their way to Manfredonia, SMS Sespel and Tatra were challenged out of the darkness by an Italian voice. But thanks to the multilingual nature of the Austro-Hungarian Navy, Linienschiffleutnant Pitamik aboard the Sespel was able to answer in fluent Italian that he was in fact the Italian destroyer Indomito. The Indomito had three funnels and Sespel had four, but one of them was quite close to the bridge and foremast, blending in the darkness, and so that particular detail was missed and the ships were allowed to proceed. However, the darkness, which in this area was also accompanied by cloud that cut out both moon and starlight, also worked against them, as without these, they couldn't actually see which targets they were supposed to be shooting at. Then, out of nowhere, somewhere between 4 and 5 in the morning, came the sound of splashing paddles. A very enterprising and presumably insomniac fruit seller had rowed out to meet them. Corvetan Captain Vukovic quickly interrogated the poor man about the locations of the railway station, signal station and factories in the area before sending him away with a bit of advanced warning about what was to come and, one hopes, also after purchasing some fruit given the amount of trouble they'd given him. Over the next half hour, the two destroyers set about a railway shed, a viaduct, some track and then the rolling stock, since both the ships and the targets were so close to the shoreline on the respective sides of the shore that it was possible to target individual locomotives. Meanwhile, nearby at Barletta, the cruiser SMS Helgoland and the destroyer Orgen shelled the city for half an hour before spotting a pair of shadows in the early morning darkness. Helgoland immediately switched to target them and the ships split up and ran. It turned out that the two forms were the small Italian destroyer Turbine, back from the day before, with its sister ship the Aquilone. Unfortunately for the Regia Marina forces, the Sespel and Tatra were moving in from behind them, and from yet another direction came the Lika, as they were all heading for the rendezvous with the Helgoland, thus unintentionally boxing the Italians in. Lika scored a hit on the Turbine's boilers, crippling the ship, which quickly suffered a number of additional hits as it slowed. The Turbine then struck its flag and scuttled itself once the crew were safely off. The Austro-Hungarian ships picked up 35 survivors but missed 10 others in the darkness, who would fortunately later be picked up by Regia Marina forces after dawn. Turbine, however, refused to sink quickly, and Lika decided to speed up the process with a torpedo. Helgoland had tried to run down the Aquilone, but the swift Italian vessel managed to evade and vanish into the darkness. With this last force now fully assembled, the last Austro-Hungarian forces also now withdrew to base. On the Austro-Hungarian side, the operation was a resounding success. Little damage and few casualties had been suffered, and the damage to various bits of infrastructure, especially the numerous damaged and destroyed trains, stations, bridges and track, would delay Italian mobilisation for several weeks whilst repairs were being undertaken and defensive positions to prevent the Austro-Hungarians doing it again were strengthened. This enabled the Austro-Hungarian army to get their own troops into position and dug in, which would significantly slow an Italian advance that might otherwise have proved to be able to do significant damage to the Austro-Hungarian western flank. The war in the Adriatic Sea in general would continue, with the Austro-Hungarian fleet reverting back to a fleet in being, forcing the Allies to commit a large number of forces to supporting the Otranto barrage, which was designed to keep the Austro-Hungarian fleet from leaving the Adriatic, although it would prove somewhat ineffective at stopping small Austro-Hungarian submarines from leaving and causing havoc, and it would in turn be subject to a number of raids by surface ships during the war. On the other hand, the major capital units of the Kaiserliche und Königliche Kriegsmarine would rarely leave their home ports after this incursion, in part because of the stepped-up patrols by Marine Nationale, Royal Navy and Regia Marina ships, and in part because the combination of those three navies meant the Allies now had a clear overall naval superiority in capital ship numbers in the region, as whilst Svend István would enter service later in the year, the numerous French capital ships more than made up for that, and the commissioning of Andrea Doria and Caio Duilio the following year would only extend that lead. Instead, spirited actions by destroyers and small cruisers would make up the rest of the Adriatic conflict above the waves for the most part, but that's a story for another time.
That's it for this video. Thanks for watching. If you have a comment or suggestion for a ship to review, let us know in the comments below. Don't forget to comment on the pinned post for dry dock questions.